My number 8. I can assure you it's in it every time I die with low teens. Four riffs. Four just big fuck off riffs. This is the year's standout album. It is headbanger after headbanger after headbanger. Like, I have such a thing with Every Time I Die anyway.
Yeah.
I feel like they are the great, like, it's like bands like Converge and Dillinger who have like really sizable cult followings, like really sizable. Every Time I Die, I have like half that size. And those are the bands that I put them in with because they're artistic and they're challenging and they weren't ever made for the mainstream, but they are so fucking good at what they do, they deserve to have a massive audience. And for a band that I would consider the most consistent band in rock music full stop, I don't think that they've released a record that's lower than an 8. To be releasing an album that I'd have to live with it for a while, but is right up there with the very best things that they've ever done.
Yeah.
And here's the kicker with this, right? I mean, first off, It Remembers is the single best riff of this year, bar none. Like, I'd say it all the time, but any riff that sounds like it can fit on Danzig 1 is fucking all right by me.
Yeah.
Huge, huge riff. But what really stands out for me and what really warms my heart as an Every Time I Die fan is this is a record that hints at the future with Every Time I Die. Keith Buckley, right?
Yeah.
I was having to bite my lip earlier.
Of course you were.
Is a fucking treasure to our scene, both lyrically and vocally. Now, I remember when he did the Damn Things and afterwards he was retrospectively talking about it in an interview where he said, this is more like the kind of band I would want to be in when I'm older. This is the first sign of Every Time I Die growing older a bit. I feel like things like the huge chorus in Map Change, which is, again, just outstanding. And more so the song Two Summers, with those sort of Beatles-y type desert vibes in it that kick in every now and then.
Yeah.
Like, those albums couldn't have come earlier in Every Time I Die's career. That they are not letting the quality dip at all and being able to put these extra shades in that show that they're going to be able to grow old gracefully. I mean, they put out a record of fucking just pure, slower riff-based jams like that It Remembers, and I would be beyond stoked. But it's when they're fast and they're thrashing, there's riffs that suddenly sound like fucking Sound of White Noise era fucking Anthrax. or like there's one riff, I think it's at the end of C++, that's got like this real party Cowboys from Hell type feel plugged through Every Time I Die.
Yeah.
Like, what a fucking joyous sentence that is to be able to say.
Yeah.
Like, they are just one of the greatest bands going, and is for pure riffs, for pure guitar riffs, if that's your vibe, it's the single best record of the year. Like, it makes number 8 because this year's mental.
Yeah.
But like, I think if this had come out last year, I think it would have been number 2 in my top 20. So that lets you know how high the standard is this year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Every Time I Die, low teens, number 8. What's your number 8?
My number 8, say hello for the first time in this list, but certainly not for the last time, to Mr. Greg Picciotto. Fever Daydream by the Black Queen is, I guess, I nearly went, what, from like when it's a non-metal album, what would you pick? I nearly said this, really, because
when you were talking, I was thinking this and I thought, nah, it'll be in his top 20 later.
And I was like, it's not a rock record at all.
No.
It's not, but it's so, it's dark.
If they were supporting Nine Inch Nails, it wouldn't stand out. You wouldn't go, doesn't belong here.
And it's got like, I mean, it's got that kind of dark, gothic, 80s style, post-punk party thing going on. You know, the comparisons with shit like Depeche Mode and Nine Inch Nails are there, and they're kind of
rightfully so.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I think so.
But I still think there's loads of other shit going on. I think Steve, the guitar player, doesn't get enough credit because he adds a sort of a Sonic Youth style wall of noise to some of these songs, which makes everything sound a bit more primitive and a bit more kind of like they're a band. Do you know what I mean? Like it would be, there's some stuff like I compared them to LCD Sound System once and I was like, you know, but LCD Sound System, it's a bit more fun. Do you know what I mean? Like this is not fun. This is conceived.
Apart from that first song. First song's got quite a fun vibe. And yeah. Then it gets dark.
But even that, I mean, even like you look at the lyrics and stuff, like lyrically, you know, Greg has been to some pretty fucking dark places and this has all kind of come out of, you know, him being homeless and him doing all these other different things and you know, and I've spoken to him, he's like, you know, it was something that I kept going back to as like a, you know, just to sort of keep myself sane. And I think like literally it's one of the albums that has grown on me the most throughout the year. I raved about it at the start of the year, but it's got more and more. It's also one of the few albums, probably the only album on this list that my wife likes as well. So we can listen to it together a lot.
And so it's got a lot of airtime.
Yeah, it's got quite a lot of airtime in between Rotting Christ albums. And but it is, it's brilliant. It's got all the way through. It's got so many different, it's not just kind of a Depeche Mode Nine Inch Nails album. It's got like, you know,
it's got its own character,
it's got its own thing going on. And it does remind me, you know, there are bits of like Sonic Youth and there are bits of New Order and there are bits of like Julian Cope and there's bits of like Boards of Canada and Ortecra and all these kind of electronic bands as well. But at the forefront of it, you've got a vocalist who can turn those quite difficult compositions into bangers. Like they're pop songs.
They are
and fucking bangers.
This is another one that's got a real future as well, like with Dillinger winding up. Like the Black Queen is an exciting prospect, I think, if that's what Greg decides to do full time. Like I would have no qualms on that, and that says volumes about the strength of the record.
Yeah, it's a great record.
That's Not Metal is powered by Marshall. Join us for new episodes every single Friday featuring the most honest reviews, savage opinions, and everything you need from the world of rock and metal. Go onto iTunes or SoundCloud and search That's Not Metal and subscribe today. Premium podcasts are available at thatsnotmetal.net. Come on over there and get our very best work. thatsnotmetal.net for premium podcasts. That's Not Metal, powered by Marshall, available on iTunes and SoundCloud.